Okay, so today I'm talking to Keith Johnson, who's here visiting Japan for the JOLT conference in Tokyo. Thank you very much for giving me some of your time.
Pleasure.
So you were here talking mainly about expertise.
That's right.
Yeah. Okay, so expertise is quite a difficult thing to define, I think.
Yes.
So as an expert teacher, what do you think an expert teacher should be able to do?
Well, it is difficult to define, and I think probably for many purposes you have to avoid getting into traps of definition. I'm really just, what I'm mostly interested in is good teachers, and I think a working definition of expertise is being good at something, I think. When it comes to teaching, and the simple answer is we don't yet know, which is why I'm interested. There are studies which have been done in expertise, and they've come up with some rather interesting general findings. And good teachers are flexible. Good teachers use a lot of metacognition, that is, that they think about what they're doing as they're doing it. They reflect. They're reflective. Good teachers have a rich store of information that they can draw on, a rich set of techniques, or whatever it happens to be. There are statements like that, and a lot of those statements are interestingly similar to statements about expertise in other skill areas, like playing chess or problem solving or whatever. What really interests me is that when you get down to the nitty-gritty, as it were, to the actual concrete things like lesson planning or error correction or whatever it happens to be, there are the odd article in it, but there's not been many full-size studies which have come to conclusions about expertise. That's what I find exciting. I think it's a whole manifesto of research which will eventually answer the question you've just asked.
Well, you mentioned a couple of other things like chess and so on, and
yes.
I read your introduction to the book that you edited about expertise in language
yes,
teaching.
Yes.
And it was very interesting to see that you did bring in these studies from completely different areas.
Yes.
And I always like to see, actually, when I'm reading a book about language teaching, that someone's gone outside the field.
Yes.
So what do you think we can draw from other fields?
Well, perhaps I could explain why that's, I'm interested in that. The full answer would be very long, but I've felt for a very long time that language teaching, for various reasons, has separated itself up from other forms of teaching. And the study of language acquisition has separated itself off from the study of other forms of acquisition. And that has seemed to me to have been unfortunate. From some points of view it's good, but from many points of view it's unfortunate. So I deliberately made an attempt to look into the general skills literature, which I think has got many things which can guide us, many sorts of hints about which way we might be going, etc. I mean, the reason I got it, well, there are various reasons. One of the immediate reasons why I became interested in general skills was that I was involved in a fairly large-scale research project, which was looking at task design, but not just in language teaching. It was looking at task design in mathematics teaching as well. And the members of the team included a mathematician and also someone who knew about expertise. And my role was to look at the language teaching side of it. But that brought me into contact with the literature, which is why I have that kind of perspective. To answer your question, I think there's plenty. Just looking at what's been done and also the methodology of how to go about studying expertise, all these things I think can help us.
One figure which has been bandied about quite a lot in recent years is this 10,000 hours idea that Malcolm Gladwell popularised, that if you do something for 10,000 hours, or you need that length of practice to become good
yes,
at something.
Yes.
But is it just a question of practice, or is there a bit more to it than that?
I think there's a good deal more to it. I mean, it's a popular idea, and it's often mystified me where that figure comes from.
Yes, I know.
It depends on the nature of the skill you're talking about. I mean, there's riding a bicycle, which is a skill which I'm sure doesn't need 10,000 hours. Other skills, larger level skills like piloting an aeroplane or playing chess, would need more than that, and of course it depends what you mean by mastering the skill as well.
Mm-hmm.
So the figure is doubtful. I think practice is important, and there are experiments being done which have shown that, for example, watching people learning how to roll cigars in the factory, at some point they become quicker over a period of years practicing, quicker than the machine can deliver the tobacco to them to roll. So doubtless practice plays a role, and I think that's quite interesting from a language point of view, because many people, I mean, practice has had a very mixed history in language teaching, as you will know. There was a time when practice was all, and that was followed by a time when it wasn't regarded as important. And I think that the modern perspective, and of course the modern perspective is always the most sensible one, is that it is more than that. It involves insight, it involves the intensity of practice, and all sorts of other things.
Mm-hmm. You also mentioned Dreyfus and Dreyfus's kind of five levels of expertise in the introduction. I've seen that. It's a very good book, of course, that they originally wrote about that. So from where do we start? From novice to advanced beginner, competent to proficient to expert. But do you think it is a linear progression? Do you think that once you achieve a state of expertise, is that unassailable, as it were?
No, absolutely not. I mean, it's useful. Longitudinal studies of expertise are very useful, I think, and there are many of them, because they're difficult to do. But they're certainly very useful, but there's no doubt that it's not a linear process. And indeed, that the notion is not stable. I mean, you find experts who don't always perform in an expert way. I mean, chess masters don't always win their matches, or tennis players don't always win their matches, and expert teachers don't always give good lessons. All kinds of factors which will lead to changes in the actual performance. And of course, the other thing is it can get worse. I mean, you can be an expert who over a period of time becomes non-expert, as it were, or it doesn't behave in a particularly expert way. Mm-hmm. Quite often when I ask teachers about their own history of development, they say that they felt that they were better teachers when they were younger, for example. So experience or practice is not necessarily the only factor by any means.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you. So something else I wanted to talk to you about off of the topic of expertise, actually, is that you co-edited a book in 1979, which is very important, like the Communicative Approach to Language Teaching. So can you tell us about how that book came about?
Yes, I mean, they were very heady days, like the French Revolution. They were very, very heady days. I knew the co-editor, Chris Brumfitt, because we'd done the MA together in Essex in the same year. But that apart, that in the early or mid-1970s, there were developments in which we now call communicative language teaching, which were extremely exciting, and they were taking place in a number of centres, one of which I worked in, which was Reading, but also in Lancaster, and also at the Institute of Education where Chris Brumfitt worked. And it was becoming clear that the time, it was what we now call communicative language teaching, and also very tied up with it, the notion of functional syllabus, which was particularly being developed in Reading and the Council of Europe. And it became clear that the time had come for a number of publications, and indeed more than that one publication occurred. Mm-hmm. We were trying to look at the background to communicative language teaching in that book, although there were sections which dealt with more more practical issues. And thereafter followed a whole series of books. So I think it was the spirit of the age and a realisation that something needed to be put on paper, both about the theory and the practice of what was happening.
Why do you think it was that it became the dominant kind of methodology, not across English language teaching globally, but in a certain kind of context?
I think there are a number of reasons for that. The simplest one to plot is that it was the time when within linguistics there was interest in the way was used in pragmatics and so on, rather than in language form. Indeed, one way of looking at the whole movement is to see it as a result of developments in linguistics. And you could quote Chomsky versus Hines to illustrate this movement from an interest in formal grammar to an interest in communication, and indeed communicative competence is Del Hines's phrase. So that's one movement. But I think apart from that, it also, the movement met the need which was being felt throughout the language teaching world in many countries. That there had been too much interest in grammar, and that was being expressed long before the notional functional syllabus came across. Leonard Newmark in 1966 was talking about students who had too much grammar and couldn't use it to communicate. And it wasn't just the theorists. Therefore, it wasn't just the theorists. It was language teachers finding out that who were developing a notion of what it involved to learn a language. And I think that those two things came together.
Would you say it was the last big methodology, or what do you think? Are we in this post-methods era that sometimes people talk about?
There's no doubt that if you look at, for example, task-based language teaching, they bear a great deal in common with communicative language teaching. And I remember a student approaching me at some point and asking and saying that he thought that there was nothing had happened in language teaching methodology since the 1970s, and this was a conversation that took place in the 1990s. And I think that is largely true. I think it was the largest change that has taken place for quite a few decades. There have been interesting movements, and I personally see a lot of the movements, particularly task-based language teaching, as a sophistication, a slightly different version of communicative language teaching, something that has developed out of communicative language teaching. So I think I would answer, yeah, I think it is the big change that's taking place.
Okay. So finally, I noticed on your biography that another interest of yours at the moment is the language of Shakespeare.
Yes.
Can you tell me a little bit about that?
Yes. I mean, I've always been interested in Shakespeare, and I'm now semi-retired, and so it's a prerogative of semi-retired people to do what they want to do. I wanted to do something that was involved in language, which is what I've always been interested in, and to develop my interest in Shakespeare. The book I've almost finished is called Shakespeare's English, a Guide and Activity Book.
Ah.
And its value, I don't think it says anything new about Shakespeare. If it has any value, it will be a pedagogic value in that it, to some extent, I'm exaggerating a little bit, but it attempts to teach early modern English, which was Shakespeare's version of the language, as if it were a foreign language, and it has exercises. That's exaggerating a bit, but the approach is one which says, look at, rather like Scott Thornthorpe's book about language, it looks at examples and asks people to draw conclusions about the way the grammar works, pragmatics works, and it covers all the areas of Shakespeare's
language. This is for secondary school English literature classes, or this is for non-native English?
The market is university, undergraduate, both in Britain, where some students, not all students doing Shakespeare, but a good number of students are doing courses on language and literature, and therefore they want something about language. And by the way, the book covers quite a few areas of linguistics, so it's kind of teaching linguistics in relationship to Shakespeare. It's certainly teaching language, it's talking about the development of the English language as well. So it deals with those students. There are a large number of students on the continent of Europe who have always looked at Shakespeare from a linguistic point of view, perhaps more than in Britain, where it's sometimes treated as a totally literary subject.
Yes.
But also a market I'm not too sure about, but in Asia, where there is, as there is in all the world, a huge interest in Shakespeare, and possibly not that many books which are dealing with the language side of things. So that's the market I'm in.
When can we hope to see this?
Well, it'll be the final version will be sent to the publisher at the beginning of March. So I think it would be probably October next year.
Okay.
It's been published by Pearson Education.
Okay, well, I look forward to seeing that. Sounds very interesting. And thank you for giving me your time today.
Pleasure.
Thank you.
Enjoyed it. Thank you.